So one thing I want to talk about today is how to ace that technical interview. And this is really one of the hazing processes of getting a job in tech is to, you got to get into a room with another developer or someone you've just met. They're going to introduce themselves to you, and they're going to give you a problem, and you have to solve it on a whiteboard, which is totally unnatural. I get it. You know, usually you don't code on a whiteboard. Usually you're working with people that you know. So it's a pretty intimidating process for entry-level developers. Actually, to be honest, it's intimidating for everyone. It's one of those things where even to this day, when I'm interviewing for technical jobs, I still get nervous about it. Even though I've done hundreds of them, I've been on both sides of the table, and I've also, you know, I've practiced a lot of coding problems throughout my lifetime. It still makes me nervous. So that's very natural. I wouldn't be upset that you're nervous about it. It's just something to practice for. So at Fullstack, we've invented a method that we like to call the Reacto approach to solving interview questions. So it's R-E-A-C-T-O. Nothing to do with the React framework. It's just something that as I was coming up with the acronym, I wrote them out, kind of the exact steps, and Reacto was the acronym that came out. So what does Reacto stand for? Repeat, give examples, describe your approach, implement the code, test the code, and then talk about optimization. All right, so let's start with R. Repeat the question. You won't believe how many times I'm in the interview room with a candidate, and you know, I'm excited for the candidate, and we're having a good chat, and then we get to the programming question, and I say, implement this thing, and the first thing they do is they take the cap off the pen, and they start writing on the whiteboard before they even really understood the question. And I can tell because the first step they say is something, and I just know they're going to go down the wrong path. Now, one secret is that when you're interviewing with somebody, people like to use the questions they're comfortable with. So very likely, they've done this question 100 times, and this is the first time you're seeing it. So they already know all the paths that you can go down that are going to be incorrect. So you go on the wrong path immediately, and that immediately puts the whole interview into a tough foot. So the first thing you should do is really just repeat the question, and that will oftentimes help A, help you understand it better, and B, really make sure that the things that you don't understand, you can work out with the interviewer as you're going through the repeating of the question. The second thing is to start writing out various examples. So before you even write out any code, write out, hey, here are the parameters that I'm going to pass into my function, and what do I expect to get out, right? So just create a little table, a two-column table, and say, given these parameters, what output do you expect, right? This is another way to really just understand what exactly the question is asking, because you oftentimes will get a lot of understanding by just understanding input, output, right? You're trying to, one way to think about this is that this problem is a black box. How can you start understanding what's inside the black box before you know, given something into the black box, what comes out on the other side? So list out examples. This is another great way to get the conversation, keep the conversation flowing, and make sure that you understand what the question is asking. Now, the third step, A, describe your approaches, right? So start talking about the approaches you're going to take. Are you going to look for a recursive solution, an iterative solution, a heuristic solution? So give the interviewer some insight into your logic and thought process and really help them understand kind of the track that you're going down so that, you know, you also get a little bit of read on if you're on the right path by how they respond to your question. So if you say, you know what, I'm going to take a recursive approach, and they look at you like, excuse me, then you know that, you know, you're probably on the wrong path, right? So if you say, well, I'm going to take a recursive approach, and like, okay, that makes sense, then you're playing the interviewer a little bit as well as playing the question. So, take some time to talk about your approach. Again, you know, oftentimes people give advice, keep talking in interviews. And what they really mean is this kind of stuff, right? Keep talking about your thinking, not what's going on in the code. And you realize, like, there's three things that you've done. You probably spent about 5 minutes, and you haven't taken the marker out of the case and started writing the board. All right, so after you talked about your approaches and you've confirmed your approach, you say, this is how I'm going to take, usually the interviewer will give you some sense that you're on the right path. Then you start writing on the code, going down the path of writing code. So C in Reacto is for code. And, you know, there's so many things I could say about code. We can dive into those further. If you have questions, leave a comment below. I'd love to talk about, you know, how do you actually code these different kind of problems? We have all kinds of different thoughts and ways to break down a problem. But one thing that I really like, and I heard this tip from the author of Cracking the Coding Interview, Gail McDowell herself. And she calls this breadth-first coding. So I'll give you a link to the talk she gave at Full Stack on breadth-first coding. And the idea here is it's a little bit of a hack, right? Because, you know, in programming, we like to decompose our work into functions, right? And so exactly the same thing here, decompose your approach down into the high-level functions instead of into the really what I say more like the imperative things that you're doing. So for example, instead of writing out a for loop to iterate over some part of an array or to iterate over some data structure, just write iterate data structure parentheses the data structure comma whatever, right? And then the idea here is that you're breaking down from a high level your approach into smaller steps, right? So we call this idea breadth-first coding, and I'll tell you a little bit why I think this is really an amazing hack. Is that really a lot of times you can get really caught up on something that's trivial, but is it become kind of quite complex in the minutia, right? And so those can be things like a regex, right? You can really spend a lot of time debugging a regex. Sometimes when I'm working on a regular expression, I'll spend a lot of time before I get it right. And you can really get caught up on that stuff. You can really get caught up on loop boundaries. You can really get caught up on the, you know, the different naming of variables. And these are things that it's just not worth spending the time on when you're still thinking about the problem from a high level down to a low level. And oftentimes, you know, if your approach is right, your core algorithm is right, then the fact that you wrote out, hey, this step is, you know, check the regex of this string, the interviewer won't even ask you to go implement it because they kind of assume that, you know what, as long as they understood that this is what they need to do at this point, I'm okay with that. The underlying details aren't that important. All right, so after you've done the coding, some additional tips, right? So leave yourself room between each line for edits, right? Writing on a whiteboard is not coding in, you know, VS Code or coding in Sublime Text, it's really hard to edit, right? You can't really move stuff around. So write out big and, you know, with a lot of space in between each one, because most likely you're going to go back, erase, you're going to insert some lines. And once you start writing, you know, like insert here, arrow, and a small little thing, small code everywhere, it gets hard for you to understand and hard for the interview to understand. It really just starts becoming a mess, a jumble to work on. The second thing I really like is star things that you're not sure about, right? So as you're going through, there'll be some things where you're very confident and some things where it's tickling in the back of your mind that, you know what, I should go back and check this. I'm going to just say it here and, you know, leave a star and say, you know what, I'm pretty sure this is how this function works, or I'm pretty sure these are the parameters of array reduce, or I'm pretty sure X, whatever you're pretty sure about, leave a star there, you can go back. That shows that your confidence level matched to the interviewer's understanding of your confidence level in what you're saying. Because oftentimes, if you're semi-sure about something and you don't convey that you're only semi-sure about it, and it comes off, it might come off as, okay, this person doesn't know what they're talking about. So always try to signal to the interviewer that your confidence level in what you're saying. And really, a lot of times, it's okay to use pseudocode in the interview. You know, most good companies or most good interviewers are not there to see that you know your JavaScript syntax. They're not there to see that you've memorized Mozilla Developer Network. They want to see how you think. They want to see how you break down a problem. And so it's okay to use pseudocode. So for example, if there's something that you're just, you know, a section of a code, or maybe you've broken down the code into these three major things, this one thing, this one function, you can't really figure out the syntax for it, feel free to just pseudocode it out. Just write it out in English and you'll get back to them about it. All right, so the fifth step is to test, right? So after you've written your code, you're feeling relieved. You're like, okay, I got something on the board. Now, it's very important to show your diligence and go back and say, well, let's take some of those examples I wrote down earlier and run them through my code, right? So choose a set of parameters and just run it through. And one thing I like to do is get another color marker and just kind of mark your variables as you're going through the process, right? So you're saying, okay, A here is 1. This is this loop, I is 0, as I'm going through the initial one, as I'm going through the initial loop, here's the different steps that I'm thinking it's taking, and then here's what it's changing, et cetera, right? So go through and test your code. Run the examples and see if they actually work. This is a really important step because this is, if you take this step, then most likely, unless your algorithm is perfect right off the bat, most likely the interviewer is seeing some problems that they want to see if you can also see those problems. All right, and the final step, and this is the most important, or this can be one of those ones that really differentiate you from the rest of the pack, right? You've repeated the question, you've given your examples, you've described your approach, You've written the code. You've tested it, you know, at least on the whiteboard, but not your variables. Now, last thing is the O, and this is what I call the optimization and runtime. Optimization, right? This is oftentimes the thing that especially beginners are a little confused about, but this is really the idea is how will this perform for large data sets? Or how does this algorithm that you've created perform under different kinds of data sets, different sizes of data? So, you know, this is where we hear a lot of like the big O, you know, this is big O of N, big O of N squared, big O of M times N. And, you know, maybe you went with a brute force approach and maybe you went with a recursive approach. So this is more, you know, getting into approximating big O is a little bit more detailed than I want to get to in this talk. But, you know, you really want to, you know, as you know more about big O, just specify, here's what I'm thinking about optimization. Here's what I think. I think this loop and this inner loop is going to give me an N squared. It just shows a maturity of that you're willing to, or you're able to think at a level of, you know, if I put this in code into production, what's going to happen to our code base? So, you know, why do we think the reactive framework, or why did I come up with this reactive framework, right? And I think the first thing, the most important thing is to not start writing right when you get the code, right? Because here's my picture of it, is that your brain, you know, is working on multiple levels. And as soon as you start writing, you start committing yourself into paths that could be incorrect, right? But the more you really buy yourself time, the more time your brain gets to load in all the stuff that you practice on, you've trained on. So give your brain some time to think, right? Give your subconscious brain some time to load stuff into memory before you start writing. Because once you start writing, I feel like you start committing down pathways. Two, you really want to start the conversation. Because once the conversation is flowing between you and the interviewer, it's a lot easier to continue the conversation once you're coding, right? Because then you can say things like, well, you know, I'm a little bit stuck here, but if I think back to the approach that I described earlier, I think it would look something like, you know, I need to somehow find a base case, or I need to figure out my recursive step, right? So the conversation continues to flow once it started. So some additional advice is, you know, one, just stay calm, right? You're not supposed to know the answer immediately, because, you know, these problems are meant to take some time to take some thought and to work through, right? So focus on breaking down the problem. And I think that, you know, these problems are a little bit unfair because, for example, one of my favorite examples is find me a cycle in a linked list, right? So you have a linked list, see if there's a loop in it. And the algorithm is named after somebody because I think they wrote about it in their PhD or they wrote about it in some kind of thesis paper, right? So if you don't know the answer or if you don't know that trick, it's unlikely that in a situation where you're nervous, you're going to come up with it on the spot, right? So it is a little bit of a test that, not that you're like it's some genius that can figure out all of computer science in a 30-minute interview, but that you've been exposed to this information, right? Because even after being exposed, you still have to kind of recall it, implement it, execute it. And so the reality is don't stress out that you have to figure out these things. If you don't know the answer, sometimes that's okay, right? You can still get a job. You can still get accepted to a job even if you don't get the answer. And make it a conversation. Ask questions when you get stuck. I think this is just a human nature thing. It's very awkward to be in a room with somebody and no one's talking. You know, if you ever want to do a social experiment, just go on the street, someone asks you something, and just look at them. And as you're looking at them, you're going to see them continually get uncomfortable. They start shifting around. They're going to start, you know, looking different directions because silence is very awkward. And so this is not for you because oftentimes you're the one, you're lost in thought, right? But your interviewer is sitting there like, whoa, I don't want to work with this person because every time they're stuck, they're just sitting there making me very uncomfortable, right? So you know, whether or not this is fair or not, your job is to also make the interviewer comfortable and just keep talking, keep trying to verbalize what's going on in your mind, right? Even if what's in your mind you feel a little bit is totally off the mark, right? You have to kind of let that conversation flow and learn to read the interviewer a little bit and how they're responding to your thoughts. So, and final thing, just repeat, don't start writing right away, right? It's a reflex. You want to, you know, maybe you want to buy yourself time, or I don't know why people start writing right away, but the number thing to remember is don't let your hands touch the marker. Repeat, give examples, describe your approach before you even touch the marker. And really, you know, this is something that our students at Full Stack practice a lot, and the ones who practice a lot, get good at it, they come back and tell me that it's, you know, it works like clockwork. You're in an interview, you're just thinking to yourself, reacto, 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 react-o, right? I hope this helps, and as always, the most important thing is to practice too. So there's a lot of practice interview platforms, get together with a friend, and really just go through the Reacto framework, practice it. And just as a caveat, don't go in there and say, oh, hey, interviewer, I'm using the Reacto framework, I'm gonna repeat the question. You know, make it natural. No one wants to feel like they're part of a script, right? So make it feel natural, but this is what you should be thinking inside your head is the things that I'm gonna go through. So one last time, repeat the question, list your examples, describe your approach, code, test your examples, and then talk about optimization. All right, hope that helps.